Overspeed training, and from my data and my experience, is an incredible stimulus to improve muscle synchronization and coordination. It is, it's, and the brain loves learning this process through having to feel it. I'll jump to coordination because that's one that might be the biggest impact. Coactivation is really was when an agonist and an antagonist muscle are contracting at the same time. So when running, you can obviously you can envision the quads and the hamstrings contracting at some level against each other is going to slow an athlete down. Overspeed training is a great stimulus to decrease that co-contraction. But it also is a great tool for improving left to right patterns. There's also a lot of debate out there, a lot of arguing about asymmetries. And I hear a lot of people talking about asymmetries are normal, that even really fast athletes have them. So it's normal. Don't worry about it. It's not really something that we should be focusing on. In reality, it might be very common, but it's not normal. And as I've seen asymmetries in any way improve, speed goes up. So we do a split jump test and we look at left to right power production. We do a single leg vertical jump test. As asymmetries get smaller, speed goes up, regardless of whether or not power improves or not. So I'm convinced at this point that the brain does not like asymmetries. If we can get rid of them or diminish them, the better. But it absolutely is something that we should be focusing on. And I have seen coordination patterns that are very different from left leg to right leg. And as that changes, I see speed improve. But that speaks to the level of complexity that I think the nervous system, and I guess at this point we would go into a neuromuscular system because it's kind of a combination of factors. But that speaks to how sensitive and how complex motor recruitment is, and motor activation is a very complex thing. And being able to see differences and see how they change over time has been very, very eye-opening to me. So I get an athlete, I identify that he is a neuromuscular coordination limited athlete. Therefore, I'm going to route him to more assisted sprinting. The goal being pure overspeed, not just using assistance to get them to maximum speed. So here's the process, and this, again, don't go out saying, oh yeah, we've got Alabama's sprint training program, because this is the template that we work with. This is the process that we talk through, but we'll do speed testing on a weekly basis. In weeks one and two, I'm working off of this program. 2 weeks at 5% overspeed, another 2 weeks at 10% overspeed, and then a 4 to 8 week rotation where they drop back to 5% for one workout, up to 10%. And then if they're handling the speed well, and I'll talk about the data that we kind of look at to make that determination, we're going 15 to 20%. I have actually in some pilot testing taken some athletes who are really comfortable at 20%, over 20%. But at this point, until I see great value in going beyond that, I'm not going to do it. But I'm sure there's some out there right now thinking, boy, 15, 20% overspeed is a lot. We only go there, again, if the athlete is comfortable with it and the data are suggesting that they're handling it well. I will put EMG sensors on the athletes during their 15 and 20% overspeed workouts. So I have eyes on some data to look at the patterns. And there are signals in there that I can see when subconsciously or consciously the athlete starts to get really uncomfortable. And therefore, they would not progress further if they're not ready for that. And they would just stay on a 5 and 10% overspeed if that's what they're comfortable with. The other one that I look at is observationally, and I'm not looking at running mechanics. Obviously, if there's something gross and dangerous, we're going to stop and we're going to deal with it. But generally speaking, as I put athletes into overspeed, running mechanics get better and better and better. And I think the brain's learning what it needs to do in order to sustain that speed. But what I really look for is anxiety. If or when the athlete starts to report or demonstrate some anxiety, braking is a good sign that they're starting to get a little bit anxious, and you can hear it and you can see it. But even just in talking to the athlete, you know, I explain it to my athletes that we're looking for an optimum overspeed, and it doesn't make sense to go beyond that because now we're not optimal. We're just increasing risk for less value. So they understand what I'm getting in by building that connection with them. I've had good success with athletes being very honest with me and telling me when they're starting to feel anxious. To me, that anxiety is the first sign that it's just too fast. The brain's not comfortable with it. And if the brain's not comfortable with it, it's not going to adapt to it. So we're going to stay in a range that challenges the brain to adapt, but is in a safe and comfortable range for that athlete. By the way, I've never had an athlete fall during overspeed training. I have had one. It was back with bungees. I don't even really consider that overspeed. He wasn't paying attention. The athlete in the front took off running. He was messing around. The athlete in the front was very big and strong and pulled him over. We all laughed at him. He got up. He was embarrassed and started paying closer attention during workouts. But I've never had an athlete actually fall over when we're doing these speeds. So I think the process of being mindful of how much overspeed the athlete's able to handle and gathering some information during the process has been very useful in preventing those kinds of things from happening. But the other thing I think that keeps us out of trouble is my understanding, and hopefully the athlete's understanding, that more is not better in this case. It's getting to an optimal range that helps this process to happen at the best rate. Beyond that is just risk. So by keeping that mindset, I think we've been able to stay out of trouble. I do see a pretty good amount of difference in how much and in athletes and who is comfortable at what speeds. We've got players that are really comfortable at 5%, but if I put them to 10%, I start to see some anxiety. So every once in a while, I'll expose them to that, hoping that they're going to learn it and feel more comfortable, which they usually do. But I'm going to stay in a range that's fairly comfortable for them, versus others who they're running at 20% overspeed, never felt better, love it. They want to go higher. I just prevent them from doing it. So there's a wide range. There's no set pattern that just says everybody's going to do this amount of overspeed. It's tailored to the individual.